that. And argue that with a close look of this book, book's content, one will pick up several indications of oral tradition in it.
So just to make it clear, we will provide this presentation. Just don't worry of taking picture or like that. We'll just, you know.
One of the indicators is that the whole scenario in this book is in the past tense, once upon time. I was with one of the groups that were discussing this yesterday, this chapter. And they said the Portuguese, when we tell a story, start once upon time. So, once upon time, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. No one knows that time. So, it has been passed on and on for generation, until the right time got lost. Now it becomes once upon time. Another indicator is that the main figure is portrayed as the greatest hero. He, Job, possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 female donkeys, and very many servants. So that this man was the greatest of all the people in the Egypt. The greatest. And one example of what Leonard is talking about is the repetition of the phrase, "I alone have got to tell you," which is repeated 4 times in Job 1:15-18. When he was talking, another one came. "I alone have escaped to come and tell you." As another one talking, another one came. So that is a repetition. That is the indication that this was orally transmitted. In agreement with Williams, Ezebenyo wrote, believes that prophets in the ancient Near East communicated their message orally. That message was then communicated to the king through a scribe. But before the scribe communicated to the king, he had to edit to meet the royal requirements and standards. According to him, a prophet was not allowed to go straight to the king and start talking to him. He has to go through the scribe to go and to talk to them, except Nathan, who went straight to David. Another case study of the style of the Gospel of Luke, the message, the same applies in the New Testament. We can find it internal evidence in the Gospel of Luke 1:1, which says, "Many have undertaken to draw up an account of things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the law of the word. With this in mind, since I myself carefully investigated from the beginning, I too decided to write all the accounts to you, most excellent." Luke had to interview those who had the stories about Jesus, and then carefully he compiled and made it a written document. Again, in Luke, if Luke is the author of the book of Acts, he will have another evidence of oral before written. So was Luke there when the evidence took place? As he always implies that person plural, because we always see it. They, not we, they gathered around with him and asked, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives. They, always they, all of them, spilled enough of them, meaning he was not there. He heard these stories and he wrote down.
This does not mean that there were no written revelations. We have a few examples here that tell us that, that some part of the Bible came about as written. The Ten Commandments, Exodus 31, verse 18. Moses went on Mount Sinai and God gave him the tablets. He says they were written by the finger of God. Another one is Cyrus Cylinder, also added. This was not spoken. Cyrus wrote. That says Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of earth, and he has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judea, or in Judah. Whoever is among you, of all his people, may his God be with you, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord, the God of Israel. So, you know about this. In Ezra chapter 1. Another one is the letters of Paul. Although some scholars suggest that Paul's letters were accompanied by an oral messenger, there is a great evidence that he sent written text to be read aloud publicly. The book of Revelation, in chapter 1, 10 to 12, he said, I was in the Spirit on the day, on the Lord's day, and I had behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, write what you see in a book and send to the seven churches. So, the media, both oral and written, went parallel. Now, back to oral transmission. If Williams is right when he says these oral stories that are gathered in our Bible were shared by word of mouth for centuries before they were written down, what shall we call this process of writing down a message that was spoken out? Before we answer that, scholars argue that the Gospels we have four phases or four stages or four steps. The first one is oral transmission. Jesus parables, Jesus events of healing, Jesus teaching, Jesus confronting with the Pharisees, all those were oral. We don't hear much of Jesus writing down. Now those oral traditions began to be written down in collections while the oral tradition continued to circulate. Early Christians began combining the written collection into what is called proto-gospels. Then, at the last stage, the authors of the four gospels drew on those proto-gospels and gospels and still circulating oral tradition. They produced what they call gospels. Now, transcription. The question, what do we call when a document is turned from oral to written? Here one definition. A transcription is a document made by copying down in writing something that you listen to, like audio tapes, an interview, or comments made during a meeting. So when people talk and you write what they are saying, that's a transcription. This is another definition. When someone takes an audio or video recording of an important conversation or speech and converts into it to usable text, that's transcription. Another one says transcription is, in the linguistic sense, is the systematic presentation of a spoken language in a written form.